Okay, today we are dealing with the anaerobic respiration. Yesterday we have seen aerobic respiration, that is the respiration in presence of oxygen. So quite obviously anaerobic respiration means respiration in the absence of oxygen. Okay, in animal cells, particularly in the skeletal muscle cells, anaerobic respiration may occur when they have to work very fast and with insufficient oxygen. The overall chemical equation of anaerobic respiration we can represent like this: C6H12O6. What is this? This is nothing but glucose. Okay. Glucose. So in aerobic respiration, what we have represented? Plus 6O2, isn't it? Here there is no oxygen. So what we are doing? Just aromatic in presence of what? Enzyme. So oxygen is not there. So in presence of enzymes, this anaerobic respiration takes place. And what are the products? Yes, the main product is nothing but lactic acid. Lactic acid. And then only 2 ATP. So 2 ATP. And again, heat energy is liberating, plus heat energy. Okay, heat energy. So here glucose, here in presence of enzyme, no oxidation process is taking place. In presence of enzyme, you can see anaerobic respiration takes place. And what is the product formed? The product formed is nothing but lactic acid. So the product formed is lactic acid. So here, especially in human being, where muscle cells, yesterday we have seen, last class, it is clearly mentioned that when we are doing any physical, hard physical work or exercise, you can see that muscle cells will not get proper oxygen. So that condition is called as oxygen depth, and the muscle cell get tired easily, isn't it? So that time they are respiring but anaerobically. So lactic acid is formed. So after doing the physical work, when we are resting, what happens? This lactic acid, again it is oxidized and carbon dioxide is liberating out. So aerobic respiration will start. So this is the equation to represent. Next one is what? Special points to note the above chemical reaction in anaerobic respiration in animals are as follows. So these are the special things in the anaerobic respiration you have seen. And again, what are the things? First thing is that it is a slow process. Anaerobic respiration, it's a slow process, and the reaction cannot continue for a long time. We cannot continue this reaction because the product is lactic acid and it has a toxic effect on the cell. So here the product, it is lactic acid in the aerobic respiration, is carbon dioxide and water. Whereas here it is lactic acid, and this lactic acid toxic effect, poisonous effect. Okay. So, which may cause muscles fatigue and age. Muscle cells will get fatigued very soon, that is tired very soon, and even cause pains in the muscle cell. And here again, another feature is that in this situation, there is no carbon dioxide is produced. So, anaerobic respiration does not produce any carbon dioxide. Then again, the total energy released per mole of glucose is much less compared to aerobic respiration. You can see that in aerobic respiration 38 ATP is liberating, whereas here you can see only 2 ATP. So you can say that the energy liberated or released is also very less when comparing towards this aerobic respiration. The basic steps: plant cell, how anaerobic respiration takes place, like that only in animal cell also it takes place. No difference between plant cell and animal cell.
Then
Again, the differences between the anaerobic respiration in plant cell and animal cell is shown there. That is, in plant cell, due to anaerobic respiration, what happens? The products are glucose and product of this glucose, that is ethanol and carbon dioxide, is produced in plant cell. Whereas in animal cell is lactic acid and there is no carbon dioxide production. And in plant cell, release heat energy is more, whereas here in the case of animal cell, release the heat energy is very less, and carbon dioxide is released, causes foaming in the case of plant cell. Here there is no carbon dioxide is released and no foaming. So these are the difference between anaerobic respiration in plants and in animals. So now the parts of respiration, the process of respiration, you can see in humans there are four major parts of respiration. So four parts of the respiration. First one is breathing, second one is gaseous exchange, third one is tissue respiration, and fourth one is cellular respiration. These are the four parts, major parts of this respiration. First one is called as nothing but breathing. Breathing, you know how it is happening. So the breathing, this is a physical process in which the atmospheric air is taken in and forced out of the oxygen absorbing organs, the lungs. So what is meant by breathing? Generally, in a simple way, we can say that breathing is the process in which the atmospheric air, so the air contain what? Yes, oxygen, that is taken in, and the air containing carbon dioxide is forced out from our lungs. So this process we can call it as what? Breathing. So second process is called as gaseous transport. Hemoglobin and forms a substance called as what? Oxyhemoglobin, and it is sent to all the parts of the body through arteries. So that is sent to all the parts of the body through arteries. Okay. So the carbon dioxide from the tissue is transported to the lungs by the blood, by the means of veins, in two ways. Again, oxygen will be supplied to all the cells of the body, and in turn the veins will be taking back carbon dioxide. Okay, so here by two ways the veins are taking back this carbon dioxide. First one is as bicarbonate dissolved in the plasma. And you can see the first way, the bicarbonate in the body, that is dissolved in the plasma of the blood, that the blood will be, the vein will be taking that one. Second way, it in combination with the hemoglobin of RBC as carbaminohemoglobin, that is carbon dioxide mixed with the hemoglobin, and the veins taken back this, and this is called as carbaminohemoglobin. So the two terms clearly understood, that one is oxyhemoglobin, that is oxygen combined with the hemoglobin of the blood and supplied to all cells and tissues, that is called as what? Oxyhemoglobin. Second one is called as removing this carbon dioxide, one in the form of bicarbonate, that is dissolved in the plasma of the blood. Okay, second thing is that this carbon dioxide mixed with the hemoglobin and forming a substance called as carbaminohemoglobin. So understood the difference between oxyhemoglobin and carbaminohemoglobin. Okay, So third one is called as tissue respiration. So tissue respiration is the third process of respiration. That is the terminal blood vessels, that is the capillaries, deliver the oxygen to the body cells or tissues, where oxygen diffuses through the thin walls, and in similar way the capillaries pick up carbon dioxide released by them. So the blood capillaries are taking oxygen, and in the same way it is releasing carbon dioxide. And the fourth one major part is called as cellular respiration. So cellular respiration, what happens during cellular respiration? The complex chemical changes which occur inside the cell to release energy from glucose. So the energy has to be released from where? From the glucose. So you can see that the chemical changes which occur in the cell, what for these chemical changes occur? To release energy from the glucose. So you have learned the equation C6H12O6 plus 6O2, that is oxygen. By the oxidation of glucose, 6CO2 plus 6H2O plus 38 ATP. So energy has to be released. So a common misconception is that many people wrongly say that we inhale oxygen and exhale carbon dioxide. Is it correct, children? No, we can say that alone oxygen we cannot inhale. We inhale the air containing more oxygen, and then our lungs will be giving out what? Air containing more carbon dioxide. That is the true term. Okay. So where does this respiration occurs in a cell? The cellular respiration occurs in two major phases. That is in two different places. First one is called as glycolysis, that is called as the breakdown of glucose, and second one is Krebs cycle. So these are the two phases of the respiration. So where does this glycolysis takes place? So this glycolysis, otherwise called as breakdown of glucose, that takes place in the cytoplasm outside the mitochondria. You have studied the structure of the cell. Cell is bounded by a cell membrane, and again inside the cell membrane many organelles including mitochondria, called the bodies, then nucleus, vacuoles, then what are the ribosome, lysosome, all these structures you have seen. So you already learned that mitochondria is the center of releasing energy. Okay, so here actually this respiration, two stages are there. First one is called as glycolysis, otherwise called as breakdown of this glucose, and this takes place not in the mitochondria but in the cytoplasm. Okay, so what happened here? The glucose is broken down into pyruvic acid. So in the cytoplasm, what change happens? Yes, the glucose is broken down into pyruvic acid, which again breaks down into ethanol in plants and lactic acid in animals. So the first stage in the cytoplasm, that is called as glycolysis, and here you can say that both the steps are same in plants as well as in animals. Okay, so actually what happened in plant cell, this pyruvic acid is broken down into ethanol or ethyl alcohol in plant cell, whereas in animal cell this pyruvic acid is broken down into lactic acid. Okay, so again second stage or second step is called as Krebs cycle, and this Krebs cycle takes place in the mitochondria. okay, inside the mitochondria. Second step takes place, and again this occurs inside the mitochondria and this need oxygen. Okay, so for this process what is needed? Yes, oxygen is needed. And step by step breakdown of pyruvic acid or lactic acid to produce ATP and carbon dioxide. So by the oxygen is needed, and so that this is breaking down into ATP. So in aerobic respiration, 30H ATP, adenosine triphosphate, and again carbon dioxide and water is releasing. So H plus ion, that is hydrogen ions released in the cycle, are removed through the oxygen supplied by forming H2O. So how water is formed? The hydrogen ions released in Krebs cycle, how it can be removed? By combining with oxygen and forming this water, and thus it is removed. And here much energy is released, whereas in anaerobic respiration very less energy is released. And now you understood why the our body needs oxygen. So now let us go to the respiratory organs. So you can say that, so the respiratory organs are, you can say that is a nose, start from our respiratory organs, start from our nose, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi and lungs. These are the respiratory organ of human being. So one by one let's see. You can say that first thing is a nose. You know, we have two nostrils or the two opening, that is nothing but called nose or nostrils. Next air going pipe is pharynx, and then larynx, trachea, bronchi, bronchioles. Clearly you can see here, see the structure of our lungs and our respiratory structures. Nose, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi and lungs. So nose is the external part of the nose bearing two nostrils. So this is the external part, the nose. You clearly you can see that here the nose, and it carrying two openings which is called as nostrils. So the two nostrils you can represent like this. Okay, so the external opening, otherwise called as nostrils, and that is separated by a cartilaginous septum. See, each nostril, each opening is separated by what? Yes, a cartilaginous septum. That is separation by a cartilage, not by bone, by a cartilage. Okay, and the hairs present inside the nostrils prevent large particles from entering the system. So here inside the your nostril, small hairs are present. Then again mucus is also present. The nose inside is bit wet. Okay, so this mucus as well as this hairs present, it prevent the these dust particle and other germs directly entering into our lungs. The two nostrils are open into a pair of nasal chambers. The inner lining of the nasal chambers perform three functions. So here you can say that this is the nasal chamber. So there's two opening, it join the exterior pulse. Here this part, these two opening join together and is called as, see, the common opening. These are nostrils. And this is nasal chamber. Okay, these are the nasal chamber, and it has three functions. What are the three functions of this one, nasal chamber? First one, it warms the air as it passes over. So when it passes over, what happens? The air get warm. Okay, then it add moisture to the air. So second thing, the air which entered into the this nostril, you can say that it get water. moisture. It is mixed with moisture, and its mucus secretion entraps harmful particle. Again, the mucus membrane present inside this nozzle, it entraps all the harmful particle, dust particle, and some bacteria or germs also. So always it is important that you have to breathe through the nose and not through the mouth. So it is very, very important that you have to breathe through the nose only and not through the mouth. An additional function of the nose is to smell. So already you understood that the structure, first one, it helps in breathing. The second function, as you know, that as it is a nose, is a sense organ, and it functions to identify the smell. So how this function? Yes, the sensory cells present in the smell are located in special pockets inside the nose or nasal chambers, and when you smell something special, you give a little sniff, means a deep breath like this, and which carries the odor in the pocket. So then here the nerve cell that is connecting nose to the brain is called as what? Olfactory nerve. And this nerve is, you can say that will reach us the special region that is called as the cerebral region, and which is the smell sensing area of the cerebrum. The olfactory nerve will be taking the senses, and brain will give you the message that you are feeling this type of smell. Okay. Then next part of this respiratory system is pharynx. So here clearly you can see this part. This part is called as what? See this part. Okay. This part is called as pharynx. So the pharynx, the nasal chamber is open into the back into a wide cavity that is called as pharynx. So here a wide cavity which is called as pharynx, and the pharynx is situated at the back of the mouth. So what here inside this region, this pharynx is located, and then it is common passage for air and food. That's why you always you might have felt while you are eating the food and talking, you may get cough, isn't it? Because there is a flap called epiglottis present in that region, in the pharynx region. While you are eating the food, you can see that flap will be coming and closing that area. So then you can swallow the food clearly. Otherwise, if you are talking while eating, you can see the epiglottis remain open, and there is every possibility that food particles may enter into the lungs and continuous cough may cause. Next region is called as the larynx. So these are closed regions only. Next, you can see that this region nothing but larynx. Here the voice box is present. In the larynx, what is present? The voice box, popularly called as Adam's apple. So the voice box or sound producing structure is present. And it is a hollow cartilaginous structure located at the start of the windpipe. Windpipe means they are going pipe like this. It will be down. This is called as what? Windpipe. So this voice box is located in this region. So here again you felt it with your fingers in front of the part of the neck. You can catch, and then you produce some sound with your finger. Clearly you can identify. Okay, when you swallow something, this part rises and falls. Clearly this part, if you look into the mirror, you can see this part will be rising falling like this. The larynx contain two ligamentous fold called as vocal cords. So sound producing structure which is called as vocal cords, and air expelled means given out forcibly through the vocal cords, vibrate them producing the sound. So when the air are blowing out by force, these vocal cords, what happens? Vibrate, and thus the sound is produced. By adjusting the distance between the two vocal cords, their tension by means of attached muscle, a range of sound can be produced. Usually you can see those people who are performing this mimicry and all, they will produce a various range of sounds, bird sounds, animal sounds, and imitating other people's sounds. All those things, by adjusting the length of this vocal cord, they can, by practice, they can produce. Okay. So next is called as the trachea. Trachea or the windpipe emerges from the larynx down below the neck when it is partially covered by the thyroid gland. So here, another in the neck region, you can see that another structure is there, which is called as thyroid gland, which is producing a hormone which is called as thyroxine, which helps in the metabolism of the body. Okay, so this is closely associated with this larynx. And again, this I already shown here, this have a ring like structures. Okay, the trachea, which have what ring like structures are present in the trachea. And what is the function of these ring like structures? Yes, the rings provide flexibility and keep the trachea distantly permanently. So it keep it little wider permanently. So provide flexibility to this trachea. It is made up of knot of bones. It is the ring like structure. It is made up of cartilage only. Okay. So next is bronchi. Close to the lungs, the trachea divides into two. See here clearly, you can see the trachea, the white colored structure. This is the trachea. So the white colored structure is, see here, this is trachea. And close to the lungs, again this structure, it is clearly dividing into two. Can you see, children? And each branch is called as a bronchus, plural is bronchi. Okay, the white colored structure that is dividing into two, and each one enters into the respective lung. So here, like this, this will be dividing, and this one, each one will be entering into the respective lungs. Two lungs are there, and each one is entering into the lungs. Okay. And again, why after entering into the lungs, what happens? This again branches. So here you can say that primary branch is there, secondary branch is there, tertiary branch is there. Like that, again branching and rebranching takes place. In one of the lungs only I am showing. Here you can see many branches happens. Like this, there are many branches in the lungs, you can see. So it is full like a network, just like a connection of network, full branches you can see. So a further branching will be there, and bronchioles are the subsequent still finer tubules of the tertiary branches. So this is bronchus. Trachea is present. Okay. And when it reaches the last branch, there will be no we can say that this cartilaginous ring like structure will not be there. And that finally it reaches where tiny air chambers, which is called as air sacs or alveoli. And these fine branches, this end thin fine air, this called as air sacs or alveoli. Like this, you can see that each branches ends in alveoli. So the last thing is that called as alveoli or air sacs. A network of blood capillaries surrounds the wall of each alveolus. The walls of the alveoli are extremely thin. So the walls of this alveoli, this structure, this round structure, that is very thin, extremely it is thin. And then you can say that it is moist also always. It is bit wet means it is moist also, and thus allowing gaseous diffusion through them. So always you can say it is very thin and it is wet or moist. These two things allows it to exchange the gas between this alveoli or air sacs and the surrounding. Okay, oxygen from the air is first dissolves in a thin layer of watery fluid that covers the surface of the alveoli. Now, what are the protective inner lining of respiratory passage? Let us see what are the protective layers. First, you can see that the entire lungs is covered by a membrane which is called as pleural membrane. Always remember, the lungs is covered by a membrane which is called as pleural membrane. The main function of it is protection. The entire inner lining of the larynx, trachea, bronchi and bronchioles are formed of ciliated epithelium. So the whole structure, this structure completely, it is made up of what type of tissues? Yes, by the ciliated epithelium. And during lifetime, the cilia are constantly in motion. Ciliated epithelium, you have studied the structure of the cell. This is the cell, and at the top, what happens? Small hairless structures which are called as cilia, which help in the movement of this material, isn't it? So here you can see that this during lifetime, what the cilia will do? Cilia means the hair-like structures. And that will be constantly in movement or in motion and driving away the fluid or the mucus that is on them. And also if any particles are attached to that one, so by lashing that cilia, it can move that one. Okay. So next one, we can go to the structure, that is lungs here. Already I have shown you there are two lungs, isn't it? That there the pair of spongy and elastic organs formed by the air sac. So the lungs are spongy as well as it is formed by the air sac. See, these are the air sacs. One of the lungs only I have shown. These are the air sacs. This is spongy and formed by the air sacs, and they are connecting bronchioles, and blood vessels are also present there. And the two lungs are roughly what shape? Cone shaped. You can say that here. This is somewhat like this. Okay, so roughly you can say that it is somewhat cone shaped in nature. The lungs are cone shaped in nature. And again, you can see the left lung has two lobes and the right lung has three lobes. So left lung has two lobes, right lung has three lobes. And what are the membrane that is covering? Each lung is covered by two membrane, the inner pleura and the outer pleura. Okay, so inner pleura is called as what? Visceral membrane. So inner pleura, otherwise called as visceral membrane, and the outer pleura, that is pleural membrane, double layered. Outside it is called as what? Parietal membrane. So in between the fluid, you can say that it is covered by like this. So in inner side, and there is an outer side, and inside this there is a fluid. That fluid is called as what? Nothing but parietal or pleural fluid. Okay, the fluid present in between is called as parietal fluid or pleural fluid. Okay. Then the lungs occupy the greater part of the thoracic cavity. Thoracic cavity means the above the diaphragm. The thoracic is this region, and it occupies a greater area, and they are located close to the inner surface of the thoracic wall, and their lower bases closely rest on the diaphragm, and the lower base is closely, you can see that it rests on the diaphragm. What is meant by diaphragm, children? The U-shaped membrane, you can see that that is an elastic membrane that is separating the thoracic and abdominal cavity. Now let us see how this blood supply to the lungs. The right auricular pump all the deoxygenated blood received in it from the body into the right ventricle. So blood circulation, how it happens to the lungs. Okay, so the right this auricle, how many chambers are there for the heart? Yes, there are 4 chambers, which are there: right auricle, right ventricle, left auricle, left ventricle. So these are the 4 chambers of the heart. Auricle is otherwise called as what? Atrium. Okay, so here the right auricle, that is upper chamber, right side upper chamber, pump the deoxygenated blood received in the form in it from the body into the right ventricle. So from right ventricle, the blood, deoxygenated blood, it reaches the right auricle and it pumps into the lungs through the main pulmonary artery. So circulatory system you will study next year in detail. So from there, through the pulmonary artery, where this blood will be reaching in the lungs. Okay, the pulmonary artery, soon after it emerges, divides into 2 branches entering their respective lungs. So from the heart it emerges out, it divides into 2 this pulmonary artery, and this pulmonary artery, one it enters into the right lung and the next one it enters into the left lung. Inside the lungs, what happens? They divide, redivide several times, and ultimately they form fine capillaries, very fine branches around the air sacs. So finally, you can see that these air sacs are here. Around these fine, very fine branches will be formed, that is capillaries, fine branches will be around the air sacs. Okay, veins arising from these capillaries join and rejoin to form 2 main pulmonary veins. So these capillaries join and rejoin together and form what? Yes, vein. And these vein, again it mainly it branch into 2, and what are the those veins? 2 pulmonary veins from each lung, which pour this oxygenated blood into the left auricle of the heart. So from right auricle, deoxygenated blood is taken and it enters into the lungs. It divides, redivides and form capillaries, and from there you can see that these capillaries unite together to form vein, branching it again, it enters into the in the form of pulmonary vein, it enters into the whatever left auricle, and here the heart is getting oxygenated blood, blood with oxygen. So here the branching of the respiratory tract is shown in the book. Okay, all of you watched that one. The bright red part represent oxygenated blood and the dull part represent what? Deoxygenated blood. Next page you can see, that is in 142, clearly you can see the bright red color lungs diagram is given, and the bright red is shown oxygenated blood, and the dull or the somewhat brownish color, that is deoxygenated blood. Okay, so again the respiratory cycle consists of inspiration and expiration. What are these 2 terms? One is called as inspiration, next one is called as expiration. Inspiration means breathing in, expiration means breathing out, and in between that there is a short pause, means a stop is there, that is called as respiratory pause, means a small stop. We will not be feeling that one. we will feel continuously breathing in and breathing out, that is inspiration and expiration. But there is a small pause in between that one, which is called as what? Respiratory pause. And in normal adults, you can say that the normal breathing range is 12 to 18 times in a minute. Normal pupil, adult pupil, 12 to 18 times she or he will breathe. And a newborn baby, whereas comparing to a newborn baby, nearly 60 times per minute they will be breathing. Okay. And slight increase in carbon dioxide content in the blood increases the breathing rate. You can see that while you are running, etc., your breathing rate will be increasing, because I told you that there is a slight increase in the carbon dioxide will be there. So next, about the process of inspiration as well as expiration.